Morning, church. Would you please stand and join me in our call to worship this morning? Almighty God, you have established the new covenant of reconciliation. Let our worship be a profession of our faith this day. Please remain standing as you are able for our opening hymn number 257, He Lives. Please remain standing as we affirm our faith together with the ancient words of the Apostles' Creed as found on the screens. Church, what is it that you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Before you're seated, turn to those around you, say good morning and God bless you this morning. Thank you, friends. You can find your seats again. God is good and all the time. Amen. Good morning and welcome to Coker Methodist Church this morning for this service worshiping our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are glad that all of you have chosen to worship with us today. My name is Adam. I get to be one of the pastors here along with Reverend Clay Smallwood. What a blessing it is to be with you here today, the first Sunday after Easter, and a special day here in the life of our church as it is our Family Serve Day and what I call our Family Witness Day. Some of you may have already had a chance to go and put together some food packs with Children's Hunger Fund in our gym. If you didn't get that chance yet, you'll get that chance at the end of the service. You can go over to the gym and take 5 minutes and put together a food pack that will really make a difference in someone's life on this Family Serve Day. I hope you'll take the opportunity to do that. Would love for you to register your attendance with us today and let us know you're here. Here in the sanctuary, there's a slip on the back of your bulletin that you can fill out and drop in the offering plate when it comes by. And if you're joining us online, you can go to coker.org/livestream. And just underneath the player, there's a link there, and that'll be a place that you can register your attendance or leave us a prayer request or whatever it is the Lord might be leading you to. Hope you'll take advantage of that and do that this morning. Like I said, today's a special day as we have an opportunity to serve as well as hear witnesses, testimonies of what the Lord is doing in the lives of children, and the lives of students, and the lives of a family here at our church. It's a wonderful day where we get to hear of all that God is doing in our midst. And so I'm glad that you're here, brothers and sisters, this time to celebrate with us. We also get to gather around the table this morning and celebrate Holy Communion. And so as we prepare our hearts to move towards coming to the table, as well as coming into a time of prayer, we do want to let you know that we are lifting up some of our brothers and sisters in need of healing this week. We know that both Mike Hinton and Vic Hauser have been in the hospital this week, and so we ask God's healing grace to continue to be with them. And we also want to let you know that Galen Jory, married name Summerall, she volunteers with the youth ministry. Some of you would recognize her, see her around. She had a baby just this morning, 9 pounds, 7 ounces. Yeah, big baby. So, mom is good, baby is good, and we celebrate God's goodness and that joy in their life as well. So, brothers and sisters, with these both joys and concerns before us, we want to go to the Lord, not only in prayer, but to ready our hearts to come to the table of the Lord this morning to celebrate Holy Communion. So, as we move toward this time, let's sing together. and sisters, that this table doesn't belong to Coker, nor does it belong to any denominational body. It belongs to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And He has opened it and welcomed anyone who would come to receive from that place. And so knowing that, brothers and sisters, hear and receive this invitation this morning. That Christ our Lord invites to His table all who truly love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin, who dwell in charity with their neighbors and intend to live a holy life. Draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, making your humble confession to Almighty God. Let us pray. Almighty and most merciful God, we confess and lament that we have sinned against You in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved You with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. Because the remembrance of our sin is more than we can bear, have mercy on us and forgive us. For the sake of Your Son, Jesus Christ, pardon us of all that is past, and grant that we may ever serve You in newness of life. To the glory of Your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In these moments of silence now, would you confess those sins that rest heavy on your own hearts this morning? Almighty God, we do confess that we do not always live up to the standard that You have set, that we fall short, that we turn our backs on Your will and on Your way. We are sorry, and we do repent. And we are grateful that You are a God who has not turned His back on us, but You instead have sent Your only Son to live, to die, and to be raised again for our sake, so that we might be forgiven and that we might be offered new life in Christ. We are so grateful for that and all that You have done. Lord, we lift before You our brothers and sisters in need of Your healing grace this day. We pray that You would surround them. We pray that You would bring healing as the great physician into their bodies. We pray that You would equip and guide all the nurses and the doctors and all of those who are caring for them. And Lord, we are grateful each and every day that You have promised to never leave us nor forsake us. We remember that. We carry it with us. And we know that You walk alongside. We love You, Lord. And we pray all these things in Your name this morning. Amen. Brothers and sisters, hear the good news of the gospel this day, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And that proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let's sing.
I'd love to invite all of the children forward for our children's time this morning. And it's a big one because it's the mystery box. So come on forward. Last week, I gave this lunchbox out and told her to bring something back, and we would make a children's sermon based off of that. So it's not alive, right? Okay, not alive. Wonderful. That's the only rule. So I have no idea what's in this box, and we're going to see what happens. How well I can think on my feet. I might crash and burn, so if I do, that'll be okay, right? Do you know what's in here? Oh, it's a scarf. It's a sweater, even better. Oh, thank you. I'm going to try it on right now, actually. Oh, wait, it's a little small for me. A little small for me. Do you guys have sweaters at home? Are you more of a jacket girl? Yeah, I'm a jacket girl. I like jackets, too. Well, we have this sweater here. And you know what's unique about this sweater that's unlike other jackets? It's knit. Somebody knit this. Or maybe a machine knit it. But one way or the other, all of these little pieces were knit together. They were all little tiny threads, and they got put together, and it formed this wonderful sweater made by Cat and Jack, size medium, if you didn't know. So this is the case. The same is true with us in Christ Jesus. In Jesus, we are one big family. And you know what the Bible calls us? It calls us the body of Christ. And so each of us are a small, little, tiny part of the body of Christ. Just like each one of these knits, each one of these threads is a small part. But if you remove one, part of it's gone, right? And if you put it all together, look at this beautiful sweater that you get. So the same is true with us. In the body of Christ, each of us are a small part, but we make up something incredible. We make up a family. We make up a force for good in this world, a force that brings the kingdom of God here on earth. That is our task. And we can do that because we're knit together really tightly, all in Christ Jesus. So thanks for bringing the sweater. I'll keep it. I'll appreciate it. Can I keep it? Oh, no, I can't keep it. I'm sorry. That's okay. Well, why don't we pray about it together? And like last week, we'll do an echo prayer. So I'll say a part, and then you repeat it after me. Can you do that, Rachel? Excellent. Yes, thank you. And then we'll invite the whole congregation to repeat it too. Is that okay? How about it? Are we ready? All right, let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for knitting us together. We know that on our own, we might be weak. But with you and together, we make up your family. Help us to continue to invite others into the family. We love you, Jesus. Amen. Thanks, guys, for coming on up. Y'all can return to your seat. I know you're anxiously awaiting your amazing leading of our song here in just a minute, so go have a seat. You can have it back, yes. Yes. Oh, yeah, and we have Mystery Box that we'll do another time, right? We're not doing that next week, yeah. So this is Pastor Adams. It goes back in his office, so we'll keep it for another time when we do it. No, not this time. We're gonna punt on that one. So excited that we have yet another offering for our children here on the screens. We have a video that we've produced of some of the kids that are just talking about what does it mean that Jesus has been resurrected, and they're just testifying to the faith of Jesus in their own lives. So I want to direct your attention to the screen for our video.
There was a chair right there, and Jesus was here, and we've been hanging out with Jesus all day long. What do you think Jesus was like?
He might be like very kind of calm and chill, like very peaceful.
I think he would be like, you know, he would just be thinking about other people, being generous.
I think Jesus will be proud of all of us. All of us for all the joy we have been giving.
So imagine for just a second that Jesus is with you all the time, okay? So do you think you would get worried if you had Jesus right beside you?
Honestly, I'd be a little worried because, like, to make, like, a good impression.
Oh, you don't want to disappoint him? Oh, interesting. That's interesting. Because you're worried that Jesus might not approve of you?
Maybe not like approve of me, but kind of be like, oh, she's kind of weird.
You think Jesus might think you're weird?
Not like weird like that, but like, I just get like worried when sometimes like in these moments when like I, like this interview, sometimes I get worried.
I don't think you need to be worried. And I think if Jesus were here, I'd be less worried, because I'd be like, he's got it. Does that make sense? Like, he's going to make sure I'm okay. Lily, do you think you would worry the same if Jesus, like, you could see him and he was right there and looking, like, right in your eyes? Would you worry? No. What's the biggest thing that happens on Easter? That happened on Easter?
Jesus died on the cross.
Well, that was on Good Friday, yeah. But what happened on Easter? He rose again. How does it change our lives? Does it matter? Like, how is our life different? Because we know that Jesus rose from the dead and he's coming again.
Makes my life different because I know that I'm special and valued.
Okay. So the fact that Jesus rose again means that
we can still believe in God to help us and Jesus.
Uh-huh.
And even if we do die, we still have a place in the kingdom of heaven.
Exactly. Like, our death, our physical death, is just the beginning of a whole new life. And you're baptized on Sunday. Like, you fully, like, grabbed a hold of, you gave a bear hug to that belief, right? That means that, so I'm just going to, like, go back for a second. That means that we've talked about, if Jesus were here, we wouldn't be worried. He'd be right there. He's got it. He loves us. And when we die, we get to be with him in a whole new way forever.
I think that's true. Because I think no matter what, we all have a place in the kingdom of heaven. And no matter what, God loves us.
I like that a lot.
Did you hear that last little nugget of truth there? I think that no matter what, God has a place for all of us in the kingdom of heaven. Honestly, we could dismiss church and go home right now, right? Like, you're not going to hear anything better than that. And straight from the mouth of one of our children. What a great word. What a great word for all of us. Thank you to the kids. Thanks to the AV team for putting all that together. That's not all. We've got more of that coming in this service. But I just think that that last word is such a good one. As we continue in our worship and prepare to give of our tithes and our offerings this morning, I want to spend just a moment to say thank you for what you do in being generous to us, because it allows us to do ministry like that. Incredible children's ministry, an incredible AV team to put together these things. And I have to tell you, the first quarter of this year has been a wonderful quarter for us. Financially, the generosity has been such an important thing, and we've done very well. And so I just want to take a moment to say thank you, and let's keep going. Let's keep going, because it allows us to know that as we go into summer, as we go into all the heavy programming with youth and with children and everything we do in the summer, that we don't have to worry, we don't have to pull back because of your generosity and your faithfulness. And this first quarter has been so good. So thank you so much for that. And so as we prepare to give of our tithes and offerings this morning and continue to be generous to the work of God here at Coker, let's bow our heads and pray together. Almighty and gracious God, we want to thank you because we understand that all we have comes from you. You have blessed us in incredible ways. So now, as we just offer a portion of what you've blessed us with back to you, we pray that you would take it and use it so that your kingdom might go out from this place and that others would come to know the glorious riches of life in Christ. And we ask it in his name. Amen.
Thank you. Standing, if you are able, and pray with me the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of the Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Today's reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 9, verses 1 through 9. This is from the New Revised Standard Version. Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murders against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light was from heaven flashed about him.
He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard the voice, but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were opened, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. This is the word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God.
You may be seated. And now, Almighty God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, present here and all over this world, grant us eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts to receive your word this morning, that it would be transformative, so that when our time of worship ends in just a short while, we would all be more in the image of Jesus than we were when it began. Amen. So every week here at Coker, we have a certain routine, and every Tuesday is meetings day here at Coker. It's where we take all of our administrative meetings, our various staff meetings, our planning meetings, all those things, and we pile them all on Tuesdays. My first meeting starts at 9:15 in the morning on Tuesday. My last meeting ends at 3:30 in the afternoon on Tuesday, and they're all just lined up one after the other. I've done this at a couple of churches now where I've just piled everything on one day. The reason I do it is because I don't like meetings. Administrative meetings tax me. They take everything out of me. I'm not that kind of a thinker or an operator. I'm a 30,000-foot person. I will come up with the idea, but if you need me to implement the idea, it's not going to go well. We have other meetings that we do every now and then that are called planning meetings or even detail meetings. When those start, usually after a staff meeting, I look at Pastor Damon and say, "It's all yours," and I get up and I leave. Because I'm not going to have anything to offer to that meeting. And so what I started doing many years ago was I just took all those administrative meetings and I piled them all on one day because I can gear myself up for one day and I can just get through it. And then the rest of the week I have to do all the work that is produced from all these meetings. Now, we start all these meetings the same way every Tuesday. We pray and we ask the Lord to guide us and to bless us. And we always pray that the Lord would allow us to lead His church well. That's the prayer that we put before it. And then at staff meeting, the largest meeting on those Tuesdays, when we go through all of the things going on in the church and begin to figure out implementation and strategy and things like that, we always start staff meeting the same way. After we pray and ask the Lord to lead us and to guide, to help us to lead His church well, I always ask the same question. And the question is, where have you seen Jesus? That's always the first question of staff meeting. Since last we met, since last Tuesday, where have you seen Jesus? Because I want to hear from everybody around the table where they've seen Jesus. And we usually think, and then people will start to talk. And they'll talk about places they've seen Jesus in the ministry here at the church. Or they'll talk about places they've seen Jesus in their family. Or they'll talk about somewhere that they saw Jesus at HEB or something like that. It doesn't have to be just church places. But I want people thinking and reflecting on where they've seen Jesus. Because what it does is it begins to be a testimony to everybody else that Jesus is doing stuff. And we get to share it with each other. You see, the problem is that we can become so tunnel visioned in our work here at the church. It's very easy to become tunnel visioned in your area of ministry, for him to become tunnel visioned in youth and family, for Damon to become tunnel visioned in Bible study and discipleship, or for Mark in music and Paul in contemporary. We become tunnel visioned in our area of ministry. And if we're in one of those dry places, and maybe the Lord's not moving the way that we had wanted and hoped he would move in different places, it becomes easy to think, well, the Lord's not moving at all because I'm tunnel visioned on my area. And so we share where we've seen Jesus so that he can hear where Jesus is showing up in Cheryl's ministry and where he can hear where Jesus is showing up in Mark's ministry. And we can all hear how Jesus is moving and at work. We bear witness to each other to remind each other that Jesus is alive and he's at work. This then creates a muscle memory in us, and we begin to notice Jesus at work in the moment, wherever we are. And we kind of file it away and think, I need to remember this so I can share it on Tuesday. Because I know I'm going to be asked, where have you seen Jesus? And that muscle memory gets stronger. And no longer are we only seeing Jesus in hindsight. Now we're beginning to see Jesus actively in the moment. And that's what we want, isn't it? That's what we all ultimately want. This is part of what we do as followers of Jesus. Part of our role in the world is to give witness to others of where we've seen Jesus. Where we've seen him at work. It lets people know that Jesus is alive, that Jesus is active, that he is doing things in our midst. We pray for eyes to see it, and then once we see it, we tell other people about it. We tell other people where we've seen Jesus at work. Saul encounters Jesus on the road to Damascus, and it's a powerful encounter. This is still Saul, not Paul. He hasn't become Paul yet. This is Saul, the Pharisee. He's out hunting down followers of Jesus. He doesn't like them. And so he's asked for letters from the authorities to go to Damascus and to find followers of Jesus. And he's going to continue to breathe murderous threats against them. He's not unwilling to see them all the way through to their death. And then on the road to Damascus, Jesus appears in front of him. He sees Jesus. The resurrected Jesus comes. And it's an overwhelming experience, an overpowering moment, knocks him down, blinds him. And it becomes a convicting moment as well. As the newly resurrected Jesus says, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Now, Saul has persecuted so many to this point that he has to ask the question when Jesus asks, why are you persecuting me? Saul responds with, who are you, Lord? And Jesus says, I'm Jesus, whom you have been persecuting. You see, Saul's running around persecuting all the followers of Jesus, thinking he's only persecuting followers of Jesus. But Jesus makes it clear, no, you're persecuting me. And so it's this convicting moment there on the road. And it's a memorable moment because he eventually gets up and leaves. He's still blind. He goes into Damascus. He isolates himself in this home, will not take food, will not take water. And you want to know what I think he's doing? I think he's running through all the prophecy. I think he's running through the law, because there was no other Pharisee like Saul. He knew the law of God. He knew the prophets. I think he's running through it in his head, lining it up with the life of Jesus, wondering, could it actually be? And so then the Lord appears to another disciple named Ananias in Damascus, and the Lord calls Ananias to go and witness to Saul, to go and pray over him, to commission him. Now, Ananias is not stupid. He knows why Saul is there, and so he responds to the Lord, maybe not. Maybe not. I mean, Lord, he's here to take people like me and persecute us, to throw us into jail, and that would be the good outcome. Like, maybe we don't do this. The Lord says, listen, I've called him, I've chosen him, and I have a mission for him, and you need to go. You see, Ananias, though he is scared, remembers that we were never promised easy. It is our job to be obedient, to go and to bear witness to all that Jesus has done in our life. And we've never been promised easy. And so he needs to be obedient. And he is. And he goes. And in the name of Jesus, he prays over Saul. And Saul is healed. The scales fall from his eyes. And because of Ananias' obedience, we have one of the greatest evangelists and missionaries that the Christian church has ever known. Because of his obedience and his willingness to go and to witness, we get the Apostle Paul. Today is Family Serve Day. It's a mission day. And mission has two primary components. We serve others and we give witness to others. We already talked about the fact that we have a chance to serve others today out in the gym. Some of you have already done it. Others of you will do it after this service. We're putting together food packs for Children's Hunger Fund. We're serving hungry families. But we also get the opportunity to hear witnesses given to us today. We've already heard from the children and their reflections on Easter and the resurrection. And now we get to hear from some of our students. We get to reflect on their life in Christ and how this church has helped to disciple them. And then we get to hear from a family of our church as well. So no need to wait any longer. Let's just get right to it. I invite you, brothers and sisters, to hear these words from some of our youth. Now, if you would, take a look at the screens.
All right, guys, thanks for coming and having a conversation with me, Rylan, Sam, Cam, and Laurel. Just talking about how Coker has influenced your faith life. And so I guess that's really my first question is, what difference has Coker made in your lives?
I think that just Coker has provided me like a place where I can have like, it's just provided me the materials, like the resources and the friends to be able to grow in my faith life. And it's given me like, just, it's given me a space that I can grow so much in my faith. And it's changed so much for me.
I feel like the adults, for me at least, are very supportive whenever I go into different Bible studies that my grandpa may be teaching. Or if I'm going to pray over someone, they will really just be like, you're doing great. I'm so glad that this is our next generation. And they're really supportive.
Yeah. So next question, I guess, would be why or what has Coker done specifically that has helped influence your decision to be followers of Jesus?
For me, I've read a lot about how, like, you get down on your knees and you just pray to God and that he's always right there. And every time I do it, I just feel like he's right there next to me. Like, he's just right there. I am in the presence of the Lord. And it's just so refreshing.
What could you point to in the last, perhaps the last year, you've been in student ministry for about a year now. Is there anything that you could point to as like, man, that is the moment for me, or this is really a time that stuck out to me that helped me know that the Lord is real, or that this is when I began my relationship with Jesus, or anything like that?
Really, last year when we went to Revive, specifically, there was one night that really stuck out to me, and it was like the night that they opened the prayer room, because like, it was just amazing. Everybody was confessing and everybody was just like, it was just beautiful, honestly. It was amazing.
Sure.
Yeah. I also liked Revive, and then I also really liked Winter Revive. It was also really fun, and I liked how they also had a night wherever you could just like stay long and like pray over people. I really liked that.
That was powerful, yeah. So what about you guys? You guys have been in student ministry a little bit longer. What?
Oh, yeah.
What would you think would, maybe not a defining event, but maybe a defining time period, maybe what happened during that time that Coker helped usher you into a deeper relationship with Christ, or what do you think?
Revive 2022, I committed my life to Christ, and then the Lord started showing me things, and it brought me way deeper into my faith life, because before, I think last February, I was just so, like, I just was not into my faith as I am now. Like, I wouldn't have read my Bible every day like I do now. I wouldn't have gone and prayed over people like I do now. But he definitely showed me a lot of things in the past summer of Vibes, and I'm really glad Clay brought us to that, because it was, like, without, like, of course the Lord has different many ways, but the Lord definitely wanted us there at Revive. I mean, all of our kids have been impacted. Like, you do not leave the same when you go to Revive or when the Holy Spirit impacts you.
Sure. What would you say to future generations, people who are maybe little or maybe not even born yet that are going to come through Coker? What would you say to them about what it means to be here at Coker and what does it mean to follow Jesus?
Yeah. Stay hungry for Jesus. That's
a good word.
Some people are just like, oh yeah, I'm hungry for Jesus. But some people are like, I am hungry for Jesus. Like, yeah. I want him here. I want to see him everywhere. I'm going to go share the word. And they follow through with it.
Well, Coker is an amazing place. I'm super glad to be a part of it with you guys. So thanks for your time. Thanks for the conversation today.
Thanks to our students for taking a few minutes to have that conversation with me a couple weeks ago. We have one more testimony I'd like to share. I'd like to invite Ben and Amanda Owens forward. I've gotten to know Ben and Amanda over the last 9 or 10 months or so, and they started serving in confirmation class with me and other areas in student ministry, and I've asked them to share a testimony this morning for just a few minutes as well. So we'll hear some on video and some in person. So Ben and Amanda Owens.
All right, good morning, everyone. Well, so Clay gave us a simple question to answer today, and we'll do our best. The question was, quite simply, what does it look like to live into the resurrected life here at Coker? And I say it was an easy question, because that's not an easy question at all. It's a weird question if to sit down and look at someone in the eyes and say, Benjamin, what does it look like to live a resurrected life here at Coker? But we thought about it, and we reflected, and it brought us immediately back to last week. You say the word resurrected, and I jump straight to Easter. Last week, we celebrated the most important moment of many of our lives here at Coker, Easter Sunday. Jesus, who had been crucified, dead, and buried, had raised himself back to life. But he didn't just resurrect himself, you see. By his death, he paid for our sins, yours and mine. Not because we deserved it, but because he loved us. He washed away all our sins in that moment of sacrifice. Jesus didn't just resurrect himself that day. He also gave a gift of resurrected life to all those who love and follow him. He brought me back from the dead on that day. And ever since I was 13, when I first accepted that truth, that I had been given a new life in Jesus, I began to learn, and I continue to learn, what it means to live a resurrected life. So what does it mean to live a resurrected life here at Coker? Like all new lives, it begins just as a child's new life. A human child isn't born with the ability to walk or talk. We have to learn the basics first. And a newly resurrected life starts with learning God's words and God's ways. And he gave us these in his scripture, the Holy Bible. And here at Coker, my family, my wife and my 3 kids who are here with us today, we've discovered so many wonderful opportunities to crack this book open and to learn about what God thinks, about what he feels, what he likes, what he doesn't like, and what he wants for us. We've heard some amazing sermons by our dear pastors. We've attended many Bible classes, both introductory and advanced. Our kids have as well. We've gone to conferences and retreats. Amanda went to a women's retreat not long ago that was life-changing for her, right here at Coker. We study his scripture not because we have to or for some sense of obligation, but we read it because we desperately desire to. We want to know our Father, who paid the ultimate price of his only son. I read the Bible to learn about my Father, but also about my brothers and sisters in Christ, you, and ultimately who I am in my new family. I study the Bible by myself. I study it here at Coker with you. I study it with my family at home at bedtime, and we also watch a movie, about 15 minutes of a Christian movie once a week, and then we discuss it. A resurrected life also means that I am no longer alone. I have my earthly family, but I also have a larger family, my brothers and sisters in Christ. And here at Coker, there are so many ways that we have found to live our life with our new family. And together we can study God's word and learn about our new life together. Sunday service is a great place to start, but it's just the door into that family's household. Beyond that, there are small groups that you can connect to both on Sunday mornings and throughout the week, where you can learn more closely who are your brothers and sisters in Christ. There are dinners on Wednesday nights and other nights where we can come and just share a meal together. There are service opportunities like what we have right outside. And of course, in homes. Many of you have invited us into your homes and made us feel welcome. But if we're talking about family, I would be remiss if I let you think that it's all sunshine and moonbeams. If you've ever been a member of a family, we get it wrong sometimes. And that's why Jesus led the example and he gave us the core family rule, which is forgiveness. A resurrected life means a life of forgiveness, both forgiving others and asking for forgiveness. I know that a resurrected life here at Coker means that sometimes I'll hurt you and you'll hurt me, but Jesus set the example that we forgive one another. We ask for forgiveness. And that starts in our own home. I regularly, almost daily, I might say, ask my own family to forgive me when I don't get it right. A resurrected life also means that I live a life that honors my Father in heaven, where I follow his footsteps and I obey his instructions, and he gave us two. The first is to love the Lord your God with all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. And the second is similar, to love your neighbor as yourself. To love God and others is God's purpose for me in my resurrected life. So what is God's number one goal? To reach out in love to my neighbors, which are quite simply all of those who are not yet a part of God's family and who aren't yet living a resurrected life. God wants me to share my story, our story, with them so that they might one day be able to join us in living a resurrected life. And here at Coker, my family has caught the vision that's reaching out in love to our neighbors everywhere you look. And Coker provides us so many opportunities. And we do that with all of our strength. And each one of us has a different type of strength. Our family has found our strength of sharing with our neighbors through the fun activities and the meals that we have here where we can invite friends. Acts of service. Here at Coker, we have discovered that there's a power in being a servant leader. Mission trips, both local and abroad. We don't share this good news of a resurrected life with our neighbors because we feel that we have to. We do it because we so desperately desire to, because we know the joy that comes from living the resurrected life as a child in the family of God. My family, we've only been members of Coker for, well, technically a couple of weeks now, but Amanda grew up in this church. But we have, as a family, found a home here, and we've been given some opportunities already to share God's love with our neighbors, and Amanda would like to share a couple of those opportunities to hopefully inspire you to find your own use for your strength in the Lord's family.
Hi, everyone. Like Benjamin said, I grew up here at Coker, but I left for about 25 years, and we just now came back, and so I'm so happy to be back here at Coker. So about a year ago, a little less than a year ago, Pastor Clay asked us if we would consider volunteering with the confirmation class. So we were asked to be table facilitators for that group, and our boys joined us in that. So we participated this last school year in the confirmation class, and it was a great opportunity not only for our boys to understand more clearly what they believe and what we believe, but for them to decide for themselves if they agree with that. And so during confirmation, you go through the Apostles' Creed that we said at the beginning of the service, and it really breaks it down into segments where you just talk about each aspect of the Apostles' Creed, and it was a way to solidify our beliefs and really understand what it is that we are believing, and also understand more about the Methodist history and Coker's history. So we've also been volunteering with the youth group, and I've been volunteering with my daughter in the kids ministry, and it's been just a blessing to pour into this next generation, like Sam was talking about in the video. And I just want to encourage each of you to just self-analyze, like, what are your gifts? Many of you are already serving in different aspects, but some of you may not be. And I just want to challenge you to look for an opportunity. There's all different uses, different skill sets can be used at Coker. So I just ask that you look and see if you can answer that question of what it looks like to live a resurrected life here at Coker. So thank you.
Well, thank you to everybody who's given witness to us today. I know it has blessed many of you as it has blessed me. Let's pray. Gracious God, thank you for being in our midst. And now as we approach your table this morning, send your Holy Spirit to bring us to this point of remembering your promises, that you will never leave us nor forsake us, and that you have offered us new life in you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. As we prepare to come, will you join me in singing this morning? As a reminder, in just a moment, you'll be invited to come forward by the ushers. We'll have stations across the front. As you come, we serve by intinction. You'll receive a piece of bread into your hands. You can dip it into the cup. You can partake and return to your seat for the conclusion of the service. If you need or require a gluten-free option, there will be one right over here by the Bell Loft. You're welcome when you come forward to just peel off over there, and they have gluten-free communion ready for you at that place. Brothers and sisters, we remember that on the night that he gave himself up for us, the Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to the Father, and he broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after the supper, he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks to the Father, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This cup is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me." Let us pray. We celebrate this memorial of our redemption, O Father, receiving these gifts of bread and wine with thanksgiving for the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for us the body and blood of Christ. And sanctify us also that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and partake of his most blessed body and blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one as your church, that Christ may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and gather us together with all your saints in the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. We ask this through your Son, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit in your holy church be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with this spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Friends, let me offer this word of invitation. It is simply to be in mission with us today. As you leave, even if you've already had the opportunity, I hope you will go into the gym, take 5 minutes to just put together a food pack with Children's Hunger Fund that will go to help feed a hungry family this week. I mentioned that in the 8 o'clock service. They all went in. Someone came out afterward and they said, Adam, it only took me 3 minutes. So we have a testimony from somebody that it took them 3 minutes. So you could stay 5 and probably put 2 together if you really wanted to. So head on over there after this and be a part of this service day. I would invite you, brothers and sisters, to stand with me as you are able for our closing hymn of commitment today, number 278. We're going to sing the first verse of Crown Him with Many Crowns. Brothers and sisters, we got people coming down left and right. I love this. This is great. Come on up. We've got people who want to join and be a part of our fellowship today, and we are so thrilled to have them. And this is just what a wonderful blessing all of this is. And so this is Ann Winsett, and she is the mother of Holly Snow, mother-in-law of Jim Snow. Jim and Holly have been here for a little bit now, and we are just so thrilled to have Ann. This family has a special place in my heart because they're Lubbock people. And when they go up to Lubbock and they come home, they bring me these little cookies from the Slayton Bakery, which is outside of Lubbock. And they're Guns Up cookies, and they're really, really good. So anyways, we're so thrilled to have Ann joining us today. And then this is the Coldaway family. And they are coming to unite with us as well. All the kids, and the kids were singing earlier, and just all this great stuff. It's just a wonderful, wonderful day. And so I'm glad to have you. And so I just want to ask you all some questions real quick this morning. Let me ask, do you believe in God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit? And do you confess Jesus Christ as Savior and put your whole trust in His grace and promise to serve Him as your Lord? And do you receive and profess the Christian faith as contained in the Scriptures? And do you promise, according to the grace given you, to keep God's holy will and commandments and walk in the same all the days of your life as a faithful member of Christ's holy church? And then finally, will you be a faithful member of the Coker Methodist Church, doing all in your power to strengthen its ministries through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness as Christ's representative in this world? Praise God. Friends, we want to renew our vow of membership along with all these brothers and sisters this morning. Will you join me as we say, we rejoice to welcome you as members of Coker Methodist Church, and with you renew our vows to strengthen its ministries through our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness as Christ's representatives in this world. Will you welcome them all home to Coker? Thanks so much. So good. Good to have you all a part of the church. Yeah, absolutely. So good to see you, man. Thank you so much. I know y'all are going to want to greet them, and y'all are welcome to return to your seats. And on your way out, I'm sure y'all will want to greet them and welcome them into the family. Oh, I'm sorry, not yet. Gail hadn't snapped the picture. We got to snap the picture. So while that's all going on, let me just say thank you all for being in worship with us today. I hope you'll go pack a food pack on your way out. I took my glasses off. I don't know why. I can't see a dadgum thing. Don't forget, the Emmaus reunion gathering is next Sunday night, 5 to 7 p.m. You can find the details for that at coker.org/events. Join them for their second quarter gathering if you are a part of the Emmaus community. Our next all-church Wednesday night dinner is April 17th from 5:30 to 7. We've got enchiladas coming that night, so invite your friends, come and be a part of the all-church dinner. Also, on that night, we're going to have a question-answer time starting around 6:30 that evening. I can't remember now if it's 6 or 6:30, so don't hold it to me. I'll tell you next week. But question answer time on our new capital campaign. Next week, we're starting in on this new sermon series called This Is Our Time here at Coker. And we're going to talk about all the incredible opportunities we have just in front of us at Coker. It's going to be the launch of our capital campaign. And on that night, on April 17th, you can come to dinner. I will be there to answer questions, as long with our capital campaign chairperson, Lee Willis, will be there, and our building committee chairperson, John Roy, will be there. We'll all be ready to answer your questions. We'll be up there. We'll have our microphones. It's going to be a great night, and we are so excited to show you what is coming up. And so I hope that you will plan on being there to be a part of that as well. All right, friends, thanks for being here today. I pray it's been a blessing for you. So receive now this benediction as you go from this place. Go out into the world knowing that you have a witness to give. And so share that story with others so that they might know that Jesus has invited them into something great. Go in that great grace and in that truth. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.